Today on the No City on the Sideline Dad podcast. Hey, I got a question. Have you ever dreamed of doing something different in life? Why didn't you do it? What was holding you back? My guest, Jennie Edwards, author of the book Bumping Down the Highway, she did something different in living her dream in an RV on the road. She says her stories and adventures next on the podcast. Let's do this.
Welcome to the No Sitting on the Sideline Dad podcast, a podcast about a journey of discovery and conversations about not sitting on the sideline of life. Let's get involved. Here's host Joe Foley.
Hey, welcome to the podcast. Hey, my name is Joe Foley, and I really want to say thank you for being here. Really, thank you. Thank you for taking time to listen to me. I know time's limited and crazy busy right now. Actually, the world's kind of slowed down the time of this recording, COVID, and we're home, but hey, you have other options for entertainment, and I really appreciate you taking time to listen to me. Next up, my guest, Jennie Edwards, author of the book Bumping Down the Highway. Jennie lives the RV life, living her dream of venturing down the road. In this interview, we talk about living her dream, getting out of her comfort zone, jumping into life, figuring things out, overcoming your fears, like doing something you always want to do, but what is holding you back? Why are you scared? Because you know what? Once you get on the other side of it, it's not that bad. We talk about the RV life from community to traveling on the open road. I kind of find that's cool. You know, you can go to different places, different parks, and meet different people, and people willing to help. It was a fun conversation with Jennie about that, and also how to enjoy life. Jennie, she has a lot of interesting tips and stories, so let's jump right in. Welcome to the podcast, Jennie.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I got to ask a question, though. What is it like in an RV, living in the RV life? What is it like?
It's amazing. So in this world, in this culture, in this community, people don't care what your religion is, what your political affiliations are, what your job is. They really only care about individuals as people. What can they do to help each other every day? We eat together. We see sights together. We have fun together. And when we have challenges, we do that together as well.
What kind of challenges does a person face as an living the RV life?
So let's think. My biggest challenge probably is laundry, finding a place that's clean and nice to do laundry. I think that's probably now my biggest challenge. It used to just be driving. When I bought my first big RV, the big motorhome, I thought, how hard can it be? I pulled a camper across the country, and I didn't test drive it. I gave them a check, and I climbed in, and I couldn't keep it on the road. So I had to quickly figure out how not to be the queen of a RV park sitting still in my new fancy house on wheels. But now, today, it's really the biggest challenge is, what am I going to do today? What are we going to cook? What are we going to eat together today?
I've got to admit, though, I mean, I have a hard time backing up a van. I can't. So I can't imagine parking an RV. I always get picked on at work about that. But what is it like, though? What is it like driving a vehicle like that?
So each one is different, and I've had all kinds now. I had the first one was a little bumper pull. It attached to the bumper. And then the next one was a big truck that pulled a camper that attaches into the bed of the truck called a fifth wheel. And then I had my giant 40-foot Class A tour bus motorhome. And now I just bought a new Class C, which is long, but it's a little smaller and a little lighter. And there are challenges with each one. I think the easiest to drive is probably this Class C. The big Class A, the big tour bus, when you drive down the road, it's like driving into a hurricane. The wind is smacking you right in the face, and trucks that go by, you feel the whole RV move because the wind has hit you. But after you get used to it, you relax. I thought I would never use cruise control in an RV, and I do every day. I can drink my coffee or my water and drive. Now people joke I back up better than I drive forwards. I can park anywhere if I have to back in.
What did you do before this? What was your life like this before?
So I was the Prada heel wearing, running through airports, successful businesswoman, 47 little black dresses, and I don't know how many pairs of shoes I had, and the Louis Vuitton purses, and it looked like I was living the American dream. That's what I was chasing, but it didn't feel like it. Instead, I worked for someone, and I had to do what they told me every day. I worked too many hours. I didn't have time for family and friends, and when I made the decision to be happily homeless, that doesn't mean I don't have a roof over my head. I do. I have a beautiful RV, but it means I don't have a physical address anymore. I worked for a multi-billion dollar publicly traded company. And when I was there, I saw too many people, young people, die. They had a heart attack, or they had a stroke, or something happened to them. And I just decided that, you know what, today's my someday. You hear all these people say, someday I'm going to do something. I made the decision that today was my someday. I'm going to live this chapter of my life for as long as I can. And it's absolutely amazing.
What are some of the thoughts that went through your head when making that decision?
There was not just a one moment when I made the decision. Mm-hmm. At first, I was forced to go on this little road trip, and I thought I would rush across the country because I had to drive, and I was going to have to stay in these little cabins with no running water and bring my own bedding. That was like way outside of my comfort zone, but it was the only place I could find that they would allow both of my dogs. And so I thought I'd do it in 4 days, get across and be done with it. And I fell in love with it. I slowed down. I started taking detours and enjoying the sight. And 2 months later, when I came back home, I decided to buy a little camper, and not to live in, but I thought, if I'm going to make any more of these trips, then I'm going to have my things with me, my 1,000 thread count sheets, et cetera. And I fell in love with the RV community there and made the decision that I would live full time in an RV. And I think it just evolved over time. It was just the people that I met, the people in RV parks. They taught me how to do everything. They taught me how to connect my RV, how to get level. They taught me everything. And then they helped me and they worried about me along the way. And I think it was the community that really made me decide this is what I was going to do.
It's interesting how you just went out and you leaped out and jumped out and overcame your fear and did something. How does, like, you see your people when you were working and then their dreams and they're just saying, they're jumping. How did that make you feel?
Scary. So people ask me all the time, aren't you afraid? You're out there by yourself, traveling around the country. It's been 47 states now. And I tell them all the time, I'm afraid every day. I'm afraid every time I try something new. I just finally realized that courage was not a lack of fear. It was doing the thing you were afraid of in spite of the fear, because the end goal was more important. And so I believe I can do anything. I forget sometimes that I can't, like when I bought that big motorhome and didn't test drive it, or when I was driving over my first mountain. I'm afraid when I get there, but I just keep going. I just do it anyway, because I don't want to be like some people who let fears stop them from being the best person they can be, or stop them from trying new things. Well, I just get out there and I just do it.
I was thinking about, what is some interesting experience of like meeting people? What was kind of like any really cool stories you could tell?
Oh, my life is full of cool stories. So is bumping down highways. But some of them are, I would say, the first big mountain that I crossed was between Cheyenne and Laramie in Wyoming. And I had been pulling my RV, and I was really nervous about this mountain. People kept telling me, just don't burn up your brakes. Don't ride the brakes, because if you burn up your brakes, they're not going to do you any good. And so it took me a while to get across this mountain. I even stopped just before the mountain, before the crest, and considered asking if I could pay someone to drive me across the mountain. And I thought about turning around. I thought, maybe I made it this far. You know, I did something big. I went from Florida to Wyoming. I could turn around now and it would be okay. And decided that, nope, I'm going over the mountain. So me and my fear of keeping my foot on the brake, I really didn't know how you were supposed to accomplish this. I was going too fast when I hit the top of the mountain. And when I started going down, I kept speeding up faster and faster and faster and faster. I mean, it was like 35 to 45, 50 in seconds, in minutes. And I kept tapping my brakes, and I had trailer brakes that I was working with my hand, and the trailer brakes were screaming. That was the day that literally I accepted the fact that I was going to die. And it was, I felt sick to my stomach. I was hot. And then I thought, if I find one of these runoffs, these emergency truck runoffs, I won't kill somebody else in the process. So I'm looking, and then I hear this voice in my head that says, put your foot on the brake right now. And I literally, you hear people say they were standing on the brake.
Mm-hmm.
I literally, my rear end came out of my seat, and I was standing up with my foot on the brake. And it was pretty incredible because I found out what I wasn't doing was pushing it hard enough when I pushed it, because your engine should take over and slow you down, go into a lower gear. When I did that, it was like a roar, and then it was like a parachute grabbed me and pulled me back.
Oh, wow.
It was going pretty fast, but going slow enough that I didn't run off the side of the mountain and I made it to the bottom. So I have a lot of cool stories like that. And then there are the stories like I was traveling throughout West. I was in Idaho. On my way west, I stopped at this gas station to get gas, and the guy at the cash register said, have you ever seen Shoshone Falls? And I said no, and he made comment, you should go see it. Well, I was on my way somewhere, so I kept going. When I came back east, I didn't realize it, but I stopped at that very same gas station, and this must be this guy's stop question to anybody traveling. And when I get to the cash register, he says, have you ever seen Shoshone Falls? And so this time I looked at him and I said, no, I've seen the signs. You told me about it through last time, but can I get that beast out there down to the falls? He looked out and kind of shrugged. He said, well, maybe that's all I needed. He gave me directions and it was tough getting it down there. But I saw one of the most incredible waterfalls I have ever seen. It rivals Niagara Falls.
Oh, wow.
And this is a place that most people don't even know exists. And so there are those places that I saw or wanting to find a waterfall. I think I was in New Hampshire or Connecticut. I was somewhere northeast. And I just Googled waterfalls near me. And I found someone who posted about this waterfall, and it was not a public place. You had to, there was no sign. There was nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You had to go through the woods to get to it. And so I used all of his points of reference. You know, you look for this kind of grassy area with rocks around it. And then you follow straight back into the woods. There's going to be a path and you go right. And it eventually told you to follow the creek bed back up. And I got lost. No cell service, no nothing. But I found the waterfall. And when I got to the waterfall and I sat down there by myself, I had lunch and I was looking up at this beautiful, incredible thing. And I decided I'd had enough. And I picked up my phone, because what I do is if I go into a place like that, even if I don't have cell service, I'll take a picture of my GPS. So that hopefully with my compass, I can navigate myself back out. And when I did, it said, park car nearby. Literally, I had taken a wrong turn. It took me hours to get there.
No.
I was like a 5-minute walk from my car. But I enjoyed the journey.
That's part of the trip and the adventure you have out there. What is, like, I'm curious, because how do you get mail? That's one thing I've been thinking about. How do you get mail?
So people get mail in different ways that live this life. There are over 2 million known full-time RVers. And there are a couple of things you can have that are full-time RVers. If you have a family member, you can use their address. Mm-hmm. You have to have an address. The other thing is there are companies out there that will provide you with a physical address, and you can get, you pay them a membership fee. Your mail goes there, and they will do one of two things. You get to choose. They'll either open your mail for you, scan it, and email it to you, or they will send it to you when you tell them you're ready. They'll pack it up and send it to, say, your next stop. So there are a couple of different ways. People find ways.
What is one place, like, you've been, like truck stop and gas station? Anything cool that stands out to you?
Gas stations. My RV is gas, not diesel.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're at a truck stop, you could pull your big RV through the same place that big trucks get fuel. But I have to get this big thing through the gas area, and sometimes that's a little bit of a challenge. Sometimes I pull in and I have to circle right back out, or I don't make the turn. Truck stops, I have spent nights in truck stops, and sometimes it's a little loud. But I think overall, interesting. The biggest thing is tough getting in and out of gas stations, wrapping this big thing around and not running over anything to get out.
One thing, a quote from your book that I was reading, bumping roads are uncomfortable, but often learn the best lessons from uncomfortable situations. I mean, we mentioned about driving down the mountain. I wonder if you can share any more uncomfortable situations you overcame as your life experiences RV life.
Probably when I took my first big trip with the fifth wheel, with my first bigger RV,
mm-hmm.
the RV park I had been in, I'd taken some small trips, just going to see my brother a few hours away and then coming back. But here at, or there at Flamingo Lake RV Resort in Jacksonville, they had escorts. Mm-hmm. So when you pulled in, someone led you to your RV site, and they helped you get parked. They guided you into a space. And the first RV park on my adventure when I left was in Georgia. And when I checked in, the person handed me a map and circled where I was and where I was going. He kind of drew a line with a Sharpie saying, here's how you get to your site. And I guess I assumed all RV parks had someone that would help you. And I asked him, and he said, no, ma'am, we don't have that. This is the way you go. And then I was trying to figure out, I'm shaking like a leaf, trying to figure out how to drive, look at the map of where I'm going at the same time, and then get into my site. And I had to back into the site, brand new at doing it. And so it took me quite some time to get back in. But here in my very first site, I ran over the water line. The
oh,
water
no.
Thicket, and water everywhere. And so I climb out of my truck and I call the office and tell them, I just messed something up. I have a problem. And they were fine. They came to help me. They assured me that this happens all the time. And I think it would cost less for them to have escorts than all those things that get run over. But, you know, so it was just getting used to learning how to connect and learning how to disconnect and learning how to drive. Those things are all scary until you practice. You know, you just do it over and over. I know when I bought the motorhome and I didn't test drive it and I got in it and mm-hmm. didn't know how to drive, someone from a friend of mine from an RV park came to help me get back to the RV park and then connected me with Chuck Erwiller from RV driving school.
Mm-hmm.
And I took 2 days of private lessons with him. It was amazing. He helped me so much. You know, to get to him, it took me hours to get somewhere that probably should have taken an hour. I think I drove about 45 miles an hour down the interstate. But after 2 days of lessons with him, he had me doing everything. I could parallel park, you know, this 40-foot monster.
Parallel park? Parallel park?
Yeah. Yeah. I could do so many things. He made me drive through a movie theater parking lot. Mm-hmm. He made me drive through a Walmart and a mall and on the interstate and on back roads. And when we finished those 2 days, I said to him, so I'd like to go to Oregon to see my son for Thanksgiving. the end of next week. Mm-hmm. Would that be crazy? And he said, I told you, you needed to practice. Don't look at it as a trip from Florida to Oregon. You just do what you can every day. Don't overextend yourself. And treat each day as you're taking a practice trip, and you'll be fine. Oh, I absolutely was. I was a day late getting there, but they held Thanksgiving dinner for me. There were a lot of people there. It was amazing to know that you accomplished something, that you were able to do something. And I think I just don't know I'm afraid. Well, I know I'm afraid. I just think I can do anything and then step out there and do it before I realize I'm afraid.
Step out of your comfort zone. Get beyond that, because that's what usually people say the most success is, the most rewards are on the other side of fear.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It is on the other side of fear. Like when I got down that mountain the day that I thought I was going to die, when I hit bottom of that mountain, it was the most incredible, exciting feeling I think that I have ever had, to know, look at this. I did this. I survived this. I'm so glad I did it. I get lost all the time, and sometimes that's a little scary because you don't know if you're heading in a direction that your RV will even fit, because what if the road is too narrow or there's a low bridge? But sometimes getting lost is the best part too. And that's scary, but it's sometimes that you see the most incredible sight, getting lost.
It's kind of cool taking the back roads, taking the side streets, instead of taking the main roads, you find the really cool stuff too.
I do find some really cool stuff sometimes by accident, but I prefer back roads. I'm not in a hurry. I don't need to go 75 miles an hour down the interstate. I'd rather be 35 miles an hour going through little towns, or 45 miles an hour on these curvy back roads. There's some pretty cool places out there. Sometimes, though, I've ended up on a back road that has a detour and another detour, and my GPS says, we don't know where you are. We don't know what you're doing. I did have my GPS said to me one day, prepare to pull over ahead and walk the rest of the way. And I thought,
That's funny. I do ignore the GPS, tell them go right. Nah, I don't feel like going right. Go left. Nah, I don't feel like going left.
Right. I do that a lot. So I have to fight it, because I figure eventually it'll route me back out where I need to be. But some of the best places I've been have been because I got lost. Sometimes it was a little tough. I took the Lewes Ferry a couple of years ago. I drove got to take the Lewes Ferry. That was very exciting to drive my big bus onto the ferry and be in the front. But when I got off on the other side, I missed a turn. My GPS told me to do something, and I missed the turn. And the next thing I know, I'm on this bridge, and I'm looking over into Cape May, and I can tell that this road ends in the water. Like, not, it's way down there. But it looks like, if you can imagine, little tiny old town with lots of tourists walking everywhere. Oh, wow. and narrow two-lane streets. And so I had to figure out, how am I going to turn around and get out of here? driving a 40-foot bus, dragging a Jeep behind me. And so I get to a street, a lot of one-way streets. I get to a street and I turn right, because my thought is, okay, I turn right, I turn left, I turn left, and I turn left, and I'm back out on the road. Well, so I made the right turn, but then I saw ahead of me more water and a parking lot. Well, I made that turn, and then I made the left turn back up, but there was no red light. So here I am with people everywhere. Nobody wants to let me out in the road to turn left and cross traffic. And so I just inched until people were forced to stop, and someone from the other direction was kind enough to think, yeah, crap, she's going to run over me if I don't stop. And so I made my way back out. But because I did that, once I got to the RV park the next day, I packed up my car and spent the day in Cape May. It was genius. Sometimes you get lost. For good reasons.
I want a question. One of the interesting is, what does your family think about this?
So my brother encouraged me to do it. He said, go travel, go do the things that you want to do. My son said, go mom. And my daughter was a little more worried about me. But, you know, I think after almost five years, they might think I'm crazy, but they've accepted it. They worry. I think more than anything, it's worry. They worry about me traveling by myself.
What does it like? I mean, have you run into any bad situations?
Yeah, you run into bad situations all the time, but there are, maybe not all the time. If you do this enough, they will. But there are more good times than bad times. I mean, bad situations, like not knowing how to drive across a mountain and then ending up in the dark in the pouring rain or ending up in places that you might not be able to turn around. When I'm towing my Jeep, I flat tow it. It's called a tow. You flat tow it on the ground. All four wheels are on the ground. And you can't back up. If you had a trailer, you could, but there's no pivot point. It turns exactly the way the RV turns, and you cannot back up with it. And I think maybe twice I've ended up in places where I got stuck, and I couldn't, three times, I couldn't make the turn with it to turn around, and I'd have to get out and disconnect my car and move it out of the way and back up and turn around and connect my car again. And sometimes I'm lost in traffic. I'm in the middle of the road when that happens. So stuff happens, but you just kind of, and I might sometimes stress a little over it, but you just deal with the situation and keep going, knowing that there's something better out there beyond that situation.
Well, it's been interesting too. I was checking out your website and somebody wrote a music for your, like, for your journey. It was a video. I thought that was really cool. How did that come about?
So I didn't plan to write a book and wrote a book and didn't have to self-publish. I said I wasn't going to write it if I was going to self-publish. And so I have a traditional publisher. And then after the book and more states and people enjoying my YouTube videos or traveling with me and the posts that I shared on social media, on Facebook under Bumping Down Highways, people started telling me more and more, I feel like I'm on the road with you and I love this. Do you keep doing this? And so I'd love to do a TV show. So I started working on a pitch for a TV show. We filmed that film, that video that you saw is on my website. The Highway is the name of the song and what I would like to name the TV show. So one of my sponsors told me when I first started talking about doing the filming, he said, you've got to meet this guy. He wrote this song like 30 years ago, and other songs he wrote went somewhere, but this song is your story. And it's crazy because it really is my story. He connected us and Michael Carter, mm-hmm. who wrote the song Home Sweet Highway. He connected Michael and I talked to Michael, told him what I wanted to do, except for the song, the original song, was recorded by Lair. And I asked him, would you pick one word or two words? Instead of saying him, could you say her? Instead, I'll go one step further. Because here it was a man singing it. It was about his story. He said, I'll go one step further. I'll have a woman record it for you again. And you can use the song. And so it's pretty incredible. I think it's out there on some different sites. You can just Google Home Sweet Highway and Michael Carter. You should be able to find it. It's a cool song, but it really is my story. People think I'm crazy. They wonder why I can't settle down. And to have had somebody write that 30 years ago, I believe he wrote it for me. He just didn't know who it was for because it wasn't sung by other artists. It wasn't picked up anywhere, and now everybody that hears it absolutely loves it. So I'm working on pitching that TV show, Home Sweet mm-hmm. Highway. And for me, I talk to him almost every week. He's absolutely amazing. And I'm headed to Alaska this summer. I've been to 47 states.
Oh, wow.
Three to go. North Dakota, Alaska, and Hawaii. And I would love to get someone to pick this show up before I head to Alaska, because I think I'm going to be the first one to have RV'd all 50 states.
That's amazing. You set off 50 states. So how'd you get to Hawaii?
So I will drive my RV up through North Dakota, Canada, Alaska. When I come back down the West Coast, mm-hmm. RV, but it was about $24,000, and I decided I couldn't afford to do that. I'm not a millionaire. And so I didn't want to just say I went to Hawaii. So I'll park my RV on the West Coast. I'm flying over to Hawaii, and I will rent an RV there. I'll be there about a week. And so I can drive around the the area and hang out in an RV park in Hawaii.
Well, that's amazing. I didn't think about that. It's probably a lot cheaper to rent one there than it's shipping us over back and forth.
Oh, yeah. Way cheaper.
Well, think about your book. Your book seems like it's a very good book. It's probably, so it seems like almost like a journal of what your experience is bumping down the highway. So your next adventure will be in Alaska. One thing I would like to, I'm wondering, wrapping up, I guess, and you can leave and people overcoming their fears and just doing it.
So I was afraid. It's not the driving or going to Alaska. It's that I'm driving to Canada. So there are different laws. There are different rules. I don't know anyone there. I don't know anyone in Alaska. I'm going to be a long ways from home. And I would say to people, whatever it is you fear, find a way to overcome the fear. Identify what you're afraid of, in what exactly are you afraid of, and do it anyway. Find the resources, find people that will support you and encourage you along the way. People said I was crazy. They said I shouldn't or I couldn't do this when I first started out. And I did it anyway. I proved that no matter how crazy something might seem, you can do anything if that's your mindset.
Where they can connect you? They can find more about you?
Absolutely. So they can find me under Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. It's all under Bumping Down Highway. Or they can go to my website and access everything at www.bumpingdownhighways.com.
All links will be in the show notes for this episode. I really do appreciate, Jennie, for being on the podcast today. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. I look forward to sharing it with everyone.
Wrapping up in this episode, I really want to thank Jennie Edwards for being a guest on the podcast. You can find more about her over at bumpingdownthehighway.com. You can find all links in the show notes for this episode over at nosittingonthesideline.com/94. Hey, please reach out, leave a comment. We have a question. Hey, I'd like to hear what you thought about this episode, or just let me know how you're doing, especially in this time of the pandemic and the COVID stuff and stuff like that. I'd like to just say hello. You can find all my contact information at nosittingonthesideline.com/contact. Hey, in the near future, I'm going to get more episodes out quicker. I really got to catch up with all the great people I got a chance to interview. You're going to really enjoy the topics we're discussing, from importance of exercise, fatherhood, mental health stuff, self-improvement, stuff like that. I think you're really going to enjoy the episodes coming up. And I really want to thank you for taking time to listen to me. It's really important to me. I really appreciate it. Well, thank you for listening. Until next time, take care. Give your kids a hug. I mean, real big squeeze hug. And tell them how much you love them. God bless. Take care. See ya.